I'm Jim Paxon. On this edition of Arizona Wildlife Views, you'll see some special interactions between animals and people and what you can do to help wildlife in Arizona. All that and more on Arizona Wildlife Views.
Arizona Wildlife Views is brought to you by the sale of hunting and fishing licenses and the Heritage Fund, lottery dollars working for wildlife. Some projects made possible by the Sport Fish and Wildlife Restoration Fund.
Good evening and welcome to Arizona Wildlife Views. This is Apache Kid. He's the last horse owned by Arizona Game and Fish, and although he's retired, we really like having him around. Human beings have a natural affinity for animals. So tonight we'll show you several stories of wildlife and the people that came into their lives, beginning with a little raccoon that survived a devastating wildfire.
All day up here it was yellow. Everything was yellow. Like somebody was shining a big yellow light over the top of your house. Yeah. That was the worst day of my life.
It was the worst day in a lot of lives. 19 firefighters died in the Yarnell Hill fire when the wind shifted and flames overran their position. 100 homes in the small mountain community of Yarnell were also lost. But when tragedy strikes, small signs of hope often emerge in the most unlikely of places.
So I was in doing some work and then I heard some scratching. I thought, what are you guys doing in there? We got about 10 cats now with the fire going on and everything. So I finally got my little pin light and shined it and I thought, what in the world doesn't look like a kitty cat?
The small animal that made its way to the safety of Christine and Leon Smith's laundry room a month after the fire was a starving, exhausted, and badly burned raccoon.
If she came from the shrine, which I think she did, and I think God showed her the way, quite frankly, is my opinion. But if she came from the shrine, it's about, from our place here, maybe half a mile, thereabouts. And she would have had to travel through some pretty, not only the rough terrain, but the rough terrain on fire.
The Shrine of St. Joseph of the Mountains was heavily damaged, but in this part of Yarnell, it's also where the fire stopped. Once the Smiths realized what they had, Christine called Arizona Game and Fish, who sent their closest wildlife rehabilitation expert to rescue the raccoon.
Well, when I first saw him, even huddled in the corner, I felt like that was a burn on his legs. But I didn't realize it was as severe as it was until I got him home and was able to just sit down real quietly while he was calm and look at him in the carrier. And I realized that it more than likely was burns. And that was Sandy's first thought, was that maybe he was in the Yarnell fire.
You can see that little white band, so where the gray skin, which is her original skin, ends, and then that white band of new skin, which is new skin sort of forming out across there.
Soon the little animal was in the care of Dr. Mike Kiedrowski, who was able to determine that her injuries were about 4 weeks old, which would have put her right in the middle of the infamous wildfire. The burns to her feet and legs were severe. Even the tips of her ears were singed off. The obvious question on everyone's mind was, what were her chances for recovery?
Well, until we got her under anesthesia, I don't think we really knew the answer to that. But once we got her under anesthesia and once we got these things really looked at, I think her chances for a good, functional, pain-free life running around are outstanding. Based on the fact that, you know, she really has all the functional parts, but she won't have the dexterity of her fingers left behind, so she's really not going to be able to go out there and hunt in the wild and forage for her food. She's missing those foot pads, so she's not going to be able to climb trees and branches and things like that. And then last but not least, missing the hair off of her legs, and that's not going to come back. And because that's not going to come back, she's going to need to be insulated against some of the elements. So she's going to be a great, great candidate for an educational animal to be placed into a zoo or sanctuary.
The raccoon, who the Smiths are calling Grace, because they feel it was by the grace of God she survived, was sent to the Adobe Wildlife Center to recover until a long-term solution could be found for her. There, she took her first tentative steps and enjoyed a long, cool drink of water.
It's definitely a blessing that this little guy made it as long as he did. Tremendous amount of determination. It's just incredible. You wonder what they're thinking and what's going on in their little minds when they have to go through something like that, because you know he was running through the fire for his little legs and the tips of his ears and all to be burned as badly as they were. It's just amazing.
But a little time and a lot of care can do wonders. Just 8 weeks after coming to the Wildlife Center, Grace is showing remarkable signs of improvement. Her feet are healing, and some of her hair has even grown back. And now she's getting ready to be transferred to her new home at the Heritage Park Zoological Sanctuary. The zoo is in Prescott, only about 30 miles from the town of Yarnell.
So I think she has a great chance. And I think that putting her back in the community where the biggest impact and where, you know, this need is felt, that's a good thing. She's going back home and everybody hopefully will be happy to have her there.
The Yarnell Hill fire was responsible for an overwhelming loss of life and property and habitat. In some cases, it even tested people's faith, all of which gives the survival of one little raccoon a little more meaning than it normally might.
Yeah, she's got a rough road to go, but I think it's also part of the healing process for the community and for everybody that, you know, had any sensitivity to what this fire did. Maybe she is our local symbol as our raccoon that survived the Yarnell fire.
There's absolutely no doubt how Leon and Christine Smith feel about it.
I don't know how she made it.
It's amazing. Amazing grace.
The Mojave County Courthouse in Kingman, Arizona.
I don't know if people have been disturbing him or not, but
Game and Fish Wildlife Manager Lainey Antelik is here on a call about a possible injured owl.
That is a baby, believe it or not.
As it turns out, the bird is not injured. It's a young great horned owl that left its nest before completely mastering the art of flight.
What happens is they fall from their nest when they're learning to fly, and the mom will still continue to feed them until they can fly and kind of be on their own, so.
It probably would prefer to be back in the safety of its courthouse nest, but Antelik says the owl ought to be just fine as long as people leave it alone.
Luckily, this story was a happy ending. It's just a healthy nestling that's learning to fly, and we'll leave him alone, and hopefully everything will turn out well. So.
Responding to a call like this, protecting wild animals is one of the best parts of her job. Being forced to destroy them is the absolute worst. But it happens, and it's often the result of people feeding wildlife. It's a statewide problem, but in the Hualapai Mountains outside of Kingman, feeding wildlife is a serious concern.
You come up here in the Hualapais and you're in the pines and you're surrounded by wildlife just within 15 minutes drive time of Kingman. And there's a small community that lives up here as well. So people have homes up here, they have summer homes. Some people live here year round, but we get a lot of visitors up here as well. People come up here all the time, in fact, to view elk and deer close and personal. The reason those animals are coming into this area, and there seems to be so many of them, is because people are feeding them. We have the beautiful Hualapai Mountains, but it's kind of an ugly issue that goes on here.
It goes on everywhere, but in Maricopa and Pima counties, it's illegal to feed wildlife except for birds and squirrels. For the rest of Arizona, feeding wildlife is not against the law.
Granted, it's not illegal in Mojave County, but it's not good for the animal in the long run. Again, it's not part of their natural diet. There are actually quite a few people in this community that put out hay bales, and they put out big troughs of water to bring the elk into their yard. And you'll see there'll be 20 elk bedded down in their yard.
They just kind of hang out with little motivation to roam and forage like wild animals normally do. And when wildlife get used to people, they're more likely to get into trouble Twice in 2 weeks, Game and Fish had to tranquilize elk to remove trash can lids stuck around their necks.
You know, they're going in there now for people food.
Zen Makarski says a wildlife manager who used to work in this area once showed him proof that elk were developing a taste for junk food.
So she rolls down her window, and there's 12, in my recollection, 10 to 12 elk bedded down. I mean, completely lying on the ground. And she pulls out a bag of chips, shakes them up and down, and every single elk there stood up and walked towards us.
Animals can figure things out. They don't need us to put hay and things like that, pellets, in their yard for them.
You know, that's what I hear a lot. You know, I have to feed them. They need my help. They need this. You know, and I just like to say, stop it. You know, this is not an act of selflessness. It's an act of selfishness. This is not about helping wildlife. This is about wanting to see wildlife. And we've had many, many cases where that act of wanting to see wildlife has led in horrible, just horrible, disastrous results for the animals.
Makarski is the public information officer for the Game and Fish Regional Office in Kingman. He's constantly spreading the word that feeding wildlife is bad news for both animals and people.
Well, the bottom line for me is that humans and wildlife just don't interact real well together. You bring them in and they're facing all kinds of dangers when we draw them into the community. People are not doing them a favor.
He says it raises their risk of being hit by a car. Plus, an artificially high concentration of animals makes it easier to spread disease, and Makarski says it's like ringing the dinner bell for predators.
You're creating potential type of smorgasbord for a predatory animal.
You know, when these mountain lions are coming in here and feeding on the deer and the elk that are within this community, then you've got a dangerous predator within the community.
And when predators get used to people, they often become a risk to public safety.
You know, when we have an animal like a bear or a mountain lion that has become a danger to society and we have to remove that animal from the wild, we're the ones as wildlife managers that have to dispatch that animal. And we do it as humanely as possible, of course, but there's nothing worse than taking an otherwise healthy animal and having to put it down. We wouldn't have had to if people hadn't been feeding those animals and bringing them into their communities. We would never have had to put those animals down.
People love wild animals, but sometimes they love them to death. That familiar phrase, a fed bear is a dead bear, is more than just a cute saying. It's a serious reminder that the actions people take can lead to terrible consequences for wildlife.
And unfortunately, it seems to be a message we have to keep constantly repeating because unfortunately, sometimes they don't listen and we tend to see the same issues over and over again.
Moving day started early for two longtime residents of Adobe Mountain Wildlife Center. Montana came to Adobe Mountain in 2004, and Tika, a resident since 2006. The two are on their way to their new home at the Heritage Park Zoological Sanctuary in Prescott.
We got contacted earlier in the year about the possibility of obtaining the two eagles here at the sanctuary. So we applied for our federal permits at that time and got those paperwork affairs in order and sent off for that and have waited patiently for a few months to receive that back. In the meantime, we modified and retrofitted our current exhibits to take in the eagles should we get that permit. And we received a phone call and a message about 2 weeks ago that our permits are through, and we received the eagles just this morning.
Both birds seemed eager to check out their new surroundings at the sanctuary, where they will be on daily display to the general public for the first time.
We're especially happy about that. These eagles will be on display, so they'll be on exhibit 365 days a year. We see approximately 60,000 people here at the sanctuary a year, and hopefully more. We're excited about the eagles. I'm sure that will be huge here for Prescott.
Montana and Tika originally came to Adobe Mountain with injuries. Neither is able to fly, and they cannot be released back into the wild.
We do a lot of rescue work up here. All the animals here are taken in because of injury or abandonment or otherwise surplus to other institutions. So Game and Fish has been very instrumental in helping with that. But behind the scenes, they do an awful lot for us for the rescued animals.
You can visit Montana Antica at the Heritage Park Zoological Sanctuary in Prescott 365 days a year. Their summer hours are from 9 to 5, 7 days a week.
No shortage of critters at the Conrad Smith household in Whitman. With their great love for animals, there is always room for one more, especially when that one is a native desert tortoise in need of a home. But first, they had to build just the right habitat for it.
Go down there and get it.
So the things that we look for is obviously a burrow, and you guys have done a great job. We always want to see about 8 inches of soil around the entire burrow, and that gives it the thermal protection that the tortoise needs in both winter and in summer. We look for a lot of shade also for the tortoise, so it can have a variety of opportunities to escape the heat. And a food source. You guys have some Bermuda grass growing, you have the globe mallow, and I see that you have at least 2 water dishes, which is fantastic. And you also have a very important safety feature of a fence that surrounds the entire enclosure so that the tortoise cannot escape.
So how difficult was it to build a tortoise a home?
Oh, this was so easy. We completed building this within probably under 2 hours.
You're kidding.
No, and that was with letting the kids help and slowly fill in the centers of the blocks for stabilization.
That's great. That goes back really far.
Christina Jones is the Turtles Project coordinator for Arizona Game and Fish, and part of her job is to make sure that the tortoise the Smith family is going to adopt will come home to just the right environment.
I think the tortoise is going to do really well here. There's a lot of vegetation, there's shade, there's places where it can get direct sunlight. This is going to be a fantastic home for a tortoise, a very lucky tortoise. Over the last 2 years, we've had a considerable number of tortoises come into the program, certainly more than we are able to adopt out. And we think that it might have something to do with the economic downturn. A lot of people were downsizing from large homes with big yards to maybe condos, which are not suitable for a tortoise.
One of the facilities that houses available desert tortoises is the Arizona Sonora Desert Museum in Tucson. They've been involved in tortoise adoption for over 30 years.
You know, historically, the museum has been involved with this before Game and Fish really kind of became aware of the issue of a lot of tortoises trying to get placed back into the wild or back into homes. And we don't want the wild tortoises to be collected, but we also don't want the captive tortoises being taken from captivity and put back into the wild for fear of illnesses being transmitted to the wild population.
Today, Chrissy and her 2 children, Sydney and Noah, have made the trip to Tucson to pick out their tortoise. Rather, to let 4-year-old Noah pick out his tortoise.
I find them to be really charismatic. They're also not quite as time-consuming as your average dog or cat pet. You can go in your backyard. If you have everything that they need, if they have the food source, the water source, shade, and shelter, you can just go back there and they walk up to you, they follow you around the yard, they're constantly looking for handouts, and they're just an incredibly, surprisingly interactive member of a family.
After checking out several animals of different sizes and weights and ages, one particular tortoise seemed to take a special interest in Noah, and that's all it took for him to claim his new friend.
I want that one!
Oh, we love to see families like this that really want to make that tortoise part of their family. People don't realize tortoises can be very personable. They get very used to people. They will interact with us, follow us around.
While desert tortoises are relatively easy to care for, adopting one is a very long-term commitment.
Desert tortoises are native to the Sonoran Desert of Arizona, and they can live, I don't know, 50, maybe to 100 years. We haven't been studying them long enough to know their true lifespan, but we do know of at least one tortoise that's in captivity that's been in a family in Tucson for 102 years.
You know, we definitely enjoy Arizona's wildlife, and we like bringing not just ourselves out to it, but if we can bring something like that home, we will, and definitely since it's helping with the need for adopting tortoises, we decided we definitely wanted to do this. And it's a fun little family thing, because whenever we have a new adventure like this, or a new journey, I guess you can call it, with bringing in a new critter to the Smith family, it's kind of that another bonding moment for all of us. So I really like that.
So if you think you have the space in your yard and in your family for a desert tortoise, all the information you need is on our website. By the way, Noah named his tortoise Yoda, and he is not only thriving in his new home, but even has his own active Facebook page.
As a Colorado River guide for Lee's Ferry anglers, he shows people how to catch fish in Marble Canyon. This is Tyson Warren's fish story.
The way I got into fishing is I had a dad who was very avid about fishing, and just about every weekend I'm from Flagstaff originally, and we spent a lot of time at Ashurst Lake. I started out with a bobber and a worm or corn or Chinese dough bait, just like most kids. And even if we didn't catch a fish, I really didn't care. I was outside with my dad and we were camping and we were sitting around a campfire at night. And those are the things I think that are just as important as catching the fish itself, is the experience. I mean, look at where we are today. It's just so beautiful. And that's what hooks me on fishing, and that's what hooks me on the whole thing. It's the experience. Man, it's your buddies that you go fishing with. It's your family. It's going to different spots and seeing different parts of, especially the Western United States that we're so lucky to live in. As far as being a guide, it's the people I get to meet. It's just a great lifestyle and a wonderful way to live. And every day you go out, some days fish better than others. It really doesn't matter as long as you're out having a good time.
Come on, baby. I know you're down there. I know you're hungry.
Well, that's our show for tonight. If you'd like more information, be sure and check out our website at azgfd.gov. For all the fine folks at Arizona Game and Fish, I'm Jim Paxon. We'll see you next time.